Hi, and welcome to lesson two of complex numbers. Just to apologize for a bit of the confusion that might be occurring because of the numbering scheme that I choose. This is part three of a five-part series, even though it is just lesson two, and the reason for that is because I took lesson one and split it into two parts. So sorry if that's a little bit confusing, but I thought I'd stick with the way I originally set it up in the notes, and that's a bit of a reminder that there is a set of PDF notes that accompany this, and you are welcome, if not encouraged, to download those and follow along with the lesson with the notes. Okay, so first, just a quick recap of what we've looked at so far. So, in our first lesson, we introduced the idea of a complex number, and we started with a historical perspective of how they were used first to solve certain types of cubic equations, and in particular, how a Renaissance mathematician by the name of Cardan used the value of the square root of negative one to solve particular cubic equations. We then formally introduced the idea of an imaginary number, this number I, and then extended upon that, combining it with the set of real numbers to form what we call complex numbers. And we also defined a few simple operations we can do with complex numbers, like adding and subtracting and multiplying, and then used those skills to help us find both roots of quadratic equations. So now quadratic equations will always have two roots. Sometimes those two roots being complex, sometimes those two roots being equal. So far, we are looking at things from sort of an algebraic perspective, but in this lesson, we're going to introduce a geometric way of looking at complex numbers. And excuse me, there are a couple of reasons for doing this. Number one is having sort of a picture of being able to visualize imaginary and complex numbers. And their relation to real numbers is a good way of kind of getting a handle on them. Just like very likely the first time you were introduced to negative numbers, which is an abstract idea, you were probably introduced to placing them on a number line and saying, well, negative numbers run, if we go below zero, we go into the negatives, and so on a number line that would be to the left. And that's a way of visualizing, it's a way of making them make sense, it's a way of making the operations with these types of numbers make sense. And we're going to do the same thing with imaginary and complex numbers. So we're going to introduce the idea, whoops, sorry, of the complex plane. And we'll see about that in just a second. And then, after we've introduced this geometric interpretation, we're going to look at some properties of complex numbers that fall out of this geometric interpretation, and then use these properties to solve another problem or two. Okay. So let's get started, and we'll start with what we already know, which is a geometric interpretation of real numbers, which we call the real number line, which runs an infinity in both directions, typically with positive numbers going to the right and negative numbers going to the left. And there's no reason why we can't use this same model and construct ourselves an imaginary number line. So that's what we're going to get started with. So I got myself a number line. Each tick would be a unit of I. And so I'll just more or less arbitrarily put an I in there. But if I go one I to the right, add another I to that, I would be at two I. And if I go one more I to the right, I would be at three I, and then four I, and five I, and off into infinity. And of course, there's nothing to stop me from going to the left, going in the opposite direction. We'll denote that with a negative sign. So we would have our negative imaginary numbers, negative I, negative two I, and so on. Now, when we introduced the set of imaginary numbers in the last lesson, we said that the imaginary numbers and the real numbers are separate from each other. And that is true. However, there is a number on our imaginary number line that is not an imaginary number. I've conspicuously left it out, so you can probably guess at what that number is. That number is zero. Right there would be zero I, but zero times anything is still zero, and zero is a real number. Okay, so there's one number on the imaginary number line that is not imaginary, it's real. So our imaginary number line and our real number line intersect. And that's our way of being able to relate the two together. So since they intersect, what I can do is put them together. And I'm gonna apologize, I should have bolded this a little bit more. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna zoom in on that a little bit. Okay, so we can have our real number line running along this way and our imaginary number line running vertically like this, okay? And we call this the complex plane. And it's modeled after what we would typically call the Cartesian plane, except instead of having an x-axis and a y-axis, what we have is a real axis, which is our real number line, and an imaginary axis, which is our imaginary number line. Okay. Go back to normal here. So we call this the complex plane. Now what that means is that every unique point on the complex plane corresponds to a unique complex number. So this gives us our way of visualizing a complex number as a position on the complex plane. And that works vice versa as well. Every complex number corresponds to a unique point on the complex plane. So again, I'll zoom in here to show you what I'm talking about. But actually, no, I think you might be able to see it good enough. So for instance, there, the complex number negative 5 plus I, right there, corresponds to the point negative 5i, which is that point right there. Okay. And the point 3 minus 6i corresponds to, the complex number is 3 minus 6i corresponds to the point 3 negative 6i, which is the point right there. So each point corresponds, or each complex number corresponds to a unique point, and each point corresponds to a unique number. So we can use this as a physical model. Alternatively, we can also picture complex numbers as vectors. And if you've done a little bit of work with vectors, this is actually a really good way to look at it as well. We can look at it as vectors that start at the origin and then go to the points on the complex planes. Now, one great advantage of this is that our rule for adding vectors that you're familiar, that you're hopefully a little bit familiar with, still is consistent with our rule for adding complex numbers. So for here, I'm adding the complex numbers negative 5 plus I and 3 minus 6i, and we did that by adding the real components and the imaginary components, and we would end up with the complex number negative 2 minus 5i. But if you take a look at this diagram and the vectors and how they're related together, that's what's commonly referred to as the parallelogram rule for adding vectors. So those two rules are consistent with each other, which is good. We don't want to introduce an interpretation that's inconsistent with things that we've already defined. Okay. And this geometric interpretation was first proposed by a Norwegian by the name of Caspar Wessel, who lived from 1745 to 1818, who ironically was not a professional mathematician but a surveyor. With hindsight, this is perhaps not quite so surprising. Wessel was looking to complex numbers as a practical means of solving real-world problems that he was encountering. And indeed, by the end of the 19th century, complex numbers have become a common tool for physicists and engineers, especially in the field of electricity. And the techniques that they were finding so useful fall straight out of this geometric interpretation. And what we're going to do is start looking at some of these techniques that fall out of this geometric interpretation. So the first one will be this idea of a modulus. So I'll first write the definition here. If z, which is a complex number, is equal to a plus bi, remember the a and the b are real numbers, then the modulus of z, which we will denote with z with bars on either side of it, is given by this formula, the square root of a squared plus b squared. Okay. And hopefully that looks a little bit familiar, because it falls straight out of the geometric interpretation. If I have a vector, here's a generic vector, a plus bi, or in the complex plane, and I'm thinking about how long that vector is, And I'm using that word kind of loosely here because, you know, we can't really, in a real sense, you know, plot imaginary numbers, but that's okay. But if I think about how, you know, the length of that vector, how would I go calculate it? Well, I would calculate it by figuring out the length of each of the sides of this right triangle. And this particular vector would be A units along the real axis and B units along the imaginary axis. So using the Pythagorean theorem, this length here would be just simply the square root of A squared plus B squared. And with vectors, this corresponds to the term magnitude. Again, if you've studied a little bit of vectors, you would have encountered the word magnitude. So it's the same idea. We're giving it a different name because, again, these aren't physical vectors that we can actually hold in our hands. So we're going to call it the modulus. But the idea is the same. And in fact, the notation is the same as well. So let's do a quick example. If I have a vector 6 minus 2i and I want to find its modulus, well, all I got to do is throw them into the formula. So this isn't so big a deal. So the a would be a 6 and the b would be a negative 2. Truth be told, it doesn't matter whether the numbers are positive or negative because I'm squaring them. And once I square them, whether they're positive or negative doesn't make any difference. So 6 squared plus 2 squared is going to be 36 plus 4, which is 40. And that reduces because 4 divides into 40 and the square root of 4 is 2. So I end up with 2 root 10. So there's one term defined, this modulus. Okay. Next term, complex conjugate. And again, that might the word conjugate might be something you've seen before. Okay. Let's go through the definition first. If z, which is a plus bi, so that's our complex number, then the complex number, which we're going to denote with a z with a bar over top of it, right there, is this guy. Kind of similar to the opposite, but we're not changing both signs of the real and the imaginary part. We're only changing the sign of the imaginary part. So we get a minus bi. And this might be familiar to you because you're used to this idea, hopefully, in working with square roots and radicals. So, for instance, if I have a integer and a radical added together, like say 2 plus the square root of 5, and I'm interested in its conjugate would be 2 minus the square root of 5. Now, there are places that we would use this. Okay, and I'll get to that in a second because these places are actually remarkably similar. But let's get started with an important property of the complex conjugate. And that is that if I take a complex number z and I multiply it by its conjugate, z bar, I always end up with the modulus of z squared. And the modulus of z is a real number. So if I take a complex number and multiply it by its conjugate, I will get a real number. Now, the proof of this is pretty simple. If I take a plus bi, which could be any complex number, and I multiply it by a minus bi, I just simply use my distributive property rules to multiply that out. And the thing to notice right away is because of the difference in sign between the two operations, I'm going to end up with a negative abi and a positive abi, which of course is going to add up to 0. Remember that the I squared part is negative 1, so that's going to be negative 1 times negative b squared. That's going to be a positive b squared. So I'm going to end up with a plus b squared. And if you go back and take a look at our modulus formula, that is simply the modulus squared because a plus, you know, the modulus was the square root of a squared plus b squared. And if I take that value and I square it, squaring and square rooting being inverse functions of each other, I would be left with just what's inside, which is the a squared plus the b squared. So there's our little proof. That was easy enough. Get back to the conjugate in just a little bit. Can define one more thing, and that's called the reciprocal. Okay, a non-zero complex number z, or the reciprocal of a non-zero complex number z, which we're going to denote with z with a superscript negative 1. That's not an exponent, Sometimes students get confused on that a little bit. It's a little bit different. Actually, I guess it can be exponent now I'm thinking about it. But we're going to denote that z to the negative 1. We're going to call that the reciprocal. And the reciprocal has the property, in fact, it's its definition, that if I take a number and multiply it by its reciprocal, I'll get 1. Okay? So if you want to find its reciprocal, you got to find the number that when you multiply it against the original, you'll get 1. And this is exactly the definition of a reciprocal of real numbers. If I have a real number like, oh, I don't know, 2/3, its reciprocal would be 3/2. And the reason why 3/2 is its reciprocal is because if I multiply those two things together, I get 1. And similarly, if I have a real number like 4, its reciprocal would be 1/4. And if I multiply 4 times 1/4, that gets me 1. So that's why 1/4 is the reciprocal of 4, and so on like that. So if I want to find the reciprocal of a complex number z, what I want to find is the number that when I multiply it against that original complex number, I'm going to get 1. And we got ourselves a little formula for that. The reciprocal, if z is equal to a plus bi, and it's not 0 because I can't take the reciprocal of 0, then the reciprocal is going to be given by this formula here. Okay, you take, remember the bar means the conjugate, and you divide that by the magnitude squared. Okay, that's a statement there. You might be wondering where this formula is coming from, so I kind of really am obligated to prove it, and the proof is pretty simple. Here comes the proof. Knowing that the reciprocal is given by this formula, we're going to assume that for now, and we also saw the property that if I take z and multiply it by its conjugate, I get the magnitude of z squared. All I got to do is show that if I take z and multiply it by this z to the negative 1, I'll get 1. If that turns out to be true, then indeed this formula does give me a formula for the reciprocal. So, okay, that's z, then my z to the negative 1, according to my definition above, is z bar over the modulus squared. And putting the two together, well, I'll just put the z with the top. I got z times z bar now in the numerator. Well, z times z bar is the magnitude of z squared. So I get the magnitude of z squared over the magnitude of z squared, which is obviously just 1, which is what we need it to be. So indeed, this is a formula for the reciprocal. Okay, yeah, so what? Well, let's put this all together. Okay, this gives us a way now of defining division. Okay, just like when you subtract, the way to think about it is not as takeaway like you would have learned in elementary school. When you subtract integers, you think of it as adding the opposite integer. And when we multiply, the actual definition of multiplication is you multiply by the reciprocal. Okay. So if I have two complex numbers, we'll call them W and z can't be a 0 because you still can't divide by 0. So there's W and z. We're going to def instead, if you end up with W divided by z, the way to think of it is it's W times the inverse of z. Okay. And using what we've got so far, we can actually do a little bit of simplifying of all of this. So the inverse of z is z bar over the modulus of z squared. So we'll replace it with that. Okay. And we know that the modulus of z squared is the same thing as z times its conjugate. And doing a little bit of simplifying more, we end up with this, which is a nice little rule for division. And the thing to notice is what this is saying is that if we have a complex fraction, so w and z are two complex numbers, again with z not equal to 0, and we end up with this w divided by z business. The way to deal with that is to take both the w and the z and multiply it by the conjugate of the z, in other words, the conjugate of our denominator. So that gives us a rule for dealing with division. Okay, that was a lot of rules, and I think what's best to do now is to just go straight into an example. Oops, let me get rid of all these lines. And this is going to finish off this lesson. Now that we've got addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, defined for complex numbers, we can now create complex linear equations. In other words, equations where the variable here, the z, is a complex variable, and we have complex numbers and coefficients floating around in there. The way of working with this, as complicated as it looks, is exactly the same way as you would work with any type of linear equation, by isolating for the variable. People get confused because they see, students often get confused, they see two letters in here, the z and the I. Keep in mind again that the I is not a variable. You can't solve for I. I is a number whose value is the square root of negative 1. It's a constant in much the same way as pi is a constant. If you have a pi in the equation, you don't solve for the pi because pi is something you already know. So the variable is the z. So we got to isolate for the z. All right, well, let's do that. So here's our equation, okay? We're gonna isolate for the z. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take this positive 2z that's over here on the right side, and we're gonna subtract it and get it on the left side. That's exactly what you would do normally with linear equations. We now have two terms with z's in them. So the way you would do that is by combining them into one term and adding the two coefficients together. So we're going to add the 3 plus 2i and the minus 2 together. And we know how to add, so that's easy enough. We add those together. We're going to get 1 plus 2iz. And again, we're trying to isolate for this z right there. So what we need to do is get rid of that 1 plus 2i. Well, that's multiplication between the 1 plus 2i and the z. So what we're going to do is we're going to divide that over to the other side. Okay, again, just as you would with a normal linear equation. And this is where our now rules for division start to kick in. Our rule for division is that if I have this situation and I need to simplify this, I would simplify it by multiplying by the conjugate of the denominator. Okay, so our denominator here is 1 plus 2i. So what I'm going to do to simplify this is multiply by the conjugate of 1 plus 2i and do the same thing to the top. And that would be multiplying both the numerator and the denominator by 1 minus 2i. And I'm just going to pause on this for a second. We'll do this multiplication out in just a second. But I want to connect this to something that you probably have already seen, which is rationalizing denominators. It's the same idea. Like, so let's say I have an expression with some radicals around, like 5 plus the square root of 2. And I want to, and let's put this in the denominator fresh, put a 3 just on the top. And I want to simplify that. How do I go about simplifying that? Well, the way I go about simplifying that is by multiplying by the conjugate of the denominator. We call this rationalizing the denominator. And the conjugate of 5 plus 2i is 5 minus 2i. Of course, I have to do the same thing to the top. And if I multiply this out on the top here, let's see, we're going to get 3 times both of those terms. That's going to be 15, and then a minus 3 root 2. In the denominator, though, I'm going to have 5 times 5, which is 25. But the thing that's going to happen is, when I multiply 5 times negative root 2, I'm going to get negative 5 root 2, and then I'm going to get 2 root 2 times 5, and that's going to be positive 5 root 2, and those two are going to add up to 0. They're going to cancel each other out, which is exactly why this conjugate is useful, this changing of the sign. Still got to multiply root 2 times root 2, but that's root 2 squared, and root 2 squared is just 2, so I'm going to get minus 2, and there's now no more square root on the bottom. Just to finish this off, why don't I finish this off? We get 15 minus 3 root 2, and all over 25 minus 2, which is 23. And if I wanted to, I could even write this now as two separate parts, a rational part and an irrational part. My rational part would be 15 23rds. And my irrational part would be 3 23rds times root 2. Okay. This should be something you've seen before, something that you're reasonably familiar with, this rationalizing the denominator. What we're doing over here is exactly the same thing. Except instead of roots, it's this I number here. But what we do to get rid of the I that's on the bottom is we multiply by the conjugate. And then we use our rules for multiplication. I'm going to keep the, actually, I'm going to erase that line I just made. People can bear with me just for a second. But I'm going to keep the other stuff there so that you can see it as a comparison. So we multiply that out. So we multiply out the numerator. We're doing that in the last lesson. So I just cut right to the chase. Multiplying out the numerator gets me 5 minus 11i plus 2i squared. Multiplying out the denominator, again, because of the sign change, those middle terms are going to cancel out and add to 0. I'm just going to get 1, and then 2i times negative 2i is negative 4i squared. Remember again that I squared is a negative 1. So this is negative 4 times negative 1, and negative 4 times negative 1 is positive 4. So I'm going to end up with, oh, and the same thing, sorry, in the numerator, of course. I have another I squared. So that I squared is going to be a negative 1. So 2 times negative 1 is negative 2, plus the 5 will get me this 3. And in the bottom, I have 1 plus 4, which is going to be the 5. And again, I can split that up. Oops, that's okay. Actually, let's go back. There we go. I can split that up into two separate parts. The real part would be 3/5, and the imaginary part would be negative 11/5 I. So that's how we deal with division of complex numbers. Okay. All right. That's it. Now, that's it for the lesson. There's a problem set at the end of lesson two in the notes, and you actually now have all the skills to do all 10 of those problems in the problem set. Again, there's a full set of solutions if you want to take a look at it. And again, I would recommend to struggle with the problems just a little bit. You learn the best when you sort of have to struggle a little bit. Don't be tempted to just simply cut to the chase and take a look at the solutions. But maybe if you're having trouble with one, let it stew for a little bit. But that's it.